generation that have passed away prematurely. How was that? 30 years? You can almost count on one hand those that passed away prematurely, that and those that passed that did pass were people that were way up in age. And you have some people that did die prematurely that maybe weren't here in this ministry, you know, that long. But I just want to you understand that getting control of your body is a big issue, because spiritual things don't come that easy. I'm going to understand what I'm saying. Spiritual things do not come, what? Easy. You know, amen, I was struggling with a whole lot of things that I didn't understand about the end time. And I would say in a matter of a week's time, I said, Lord, I just got to understand this. I just got to understand this. One thing that confused me was that the Bible speaks about when Jesus rose from the dead, that people appeared in Jerusalem, saints came out of the grave. And I was trying to figure out, I said, I wonder who came out of the grave and why they came out and everybody didn't come out. And then I was trying to figure out, I say, is there going to be, when Jesus comes back, will the Old Testament saints, are they going to get up when we get up? The people during the tribulation period that were killed for the name of Jesus, you know, these 144,000, at what point are they going to rise from the dead and be judged? And even the Gentiles that will be living when Jesus comes, you know, how it's going to go down with them. Because that's a lot of things. I would say in a period of 1 week, not eating a whole lot, I think that week we went back to juicing. Y'all understand what juicing is?
Yes.
Amen. I tell you what, you know, God wants you to preserve your tongue. Is that right? So we start juicing and you know, kind of getting away from a whole lot of things. Then God began to give me a lot of enlightenment, and every issue that I didn't understand concerning end time, especially the time that when Israel, when Jesus comes back, how he's going to deal with living Israel. Because living Israel is supposed to be judged. And there's a certain part of living Israel, although they might be preserved during the tribulation and they're going to be alive when Jesus comes, but all of them are not going to go into the kingdom. And the reason why, how he's going to separate those that will go in the kingdom and those that will be destroyed. I know these are a lot of heavy issues, but everything the Bible talks about can be understood if we would just what? Take some time. I'm going to sit down. See, Daniel, not only was he disciplined, amen, that's the first thing he had going for himself, right? Remember when the news came that everybody is going to be killed? Unless somebody come up with the vision, somebody can recall that vision and interpret it. What did Daniel say? He said, just tell the king to give me a little bit more time. Give me a little bit more time. I'll come up with it. I'll tell him what he dreamed. I'll tell him what his dream meant. Guess what? He came back and got his three prayer buddies together and had a prayer meeting, and God revealed the thing. And the next day he sent word, told him, tell the king, I'm ready. Here's the vision. Here's the dream. Now, suppose he wasn't a disciplined person and he had eaten a slab of ribs. Three days before, a whole half a roast, 2 or 3 days before, and he just full of macaroni and cheese, and ate half of the peach cobbler that society exists. You know what he was like? Oh, brothers, man, I'm just heavy tonight. I don't know what I can hear from God tonight. Oh, Jesus. But that amazed me because every challenge, even when the, how many remember the fingers they showed up on the wall? Belshazzar, those fingers began to write. And the king got so nervous that his knees started trembling. So they had done a big sin. They had got through having a big party. And they had to use all of those vessels that they had brought back from Judah when Babylon captured Jerusalem, and they took all of that fabulous, rich stuff from the temple, and they brought it all back to Babylon and began to use it. They had just had a big party, 100 of his top people, no, 1,000. And man, they were having a good time, orgies, sex orgies, and drinking until they got drunk and partying, and all of them was going on. And all of a sudden, they saw those fingers right on the wall. Just a man's hand. They didn't see no man, no body, nothing. Just some man. Now, how would y'all respond? And they said again, they always said, for all the chief folk, can you interpret this, Brother Paul? Brother Rock, can you interpret? Can you interpret? What about you, brother? Brother Chico, can you interpret? Nobody could. See, the first thing, Daniel was very unselfish. He was not in it for what he could get out of it. So he did not seek his own glory. So now these are points. I'm going to bring these points out. He was not a person that was in it to get what he could get out of it. We said that he was a very humble person. He was a person that unselfish, and he wasn't, his services were not contingent upon what the king could pay. And the king probably would have paid him $1 million to interpret those things. All right, so he was unselfish, he was what? Very humble, and we do know he had a spirit of, he was persistent in prayer. Everybody said persistent in prayer. Okay, the first thing, he was disciplined, but from the other illustrations I gave you, you can see that he was very persistent in prayer, because when the challenge came for the vision to be recalled and to interpret, what did they use? They used prayer, and they talked a lot about prayer and praise. And remember, in Daniel, it mentions about he prayed and he gave thanks 3 times a day. See, this is the way that you really cultivate the Spirit of God and develop so that you can become disciplined and sensitive to what God is saying. All of these principles have to be what? Amen. In play. The self-restraint. Everybody said self-restraint. You just can't eat anything you want to. Eat all, you know, all this pile of food. And all this dead food anyway. I can't understand why everybody just want to just pile themselves full with a bunch of dead food. Anybody know what dead food is? Can anybody help me out? Brother Rick is at me. Alright, dead food is anything that's what? Not alive. No enzymes. In other words, you cook it until everything is gone. I remember cooking them cabbage until they were brown. 3 hours. Cabbage, that's right. Cooking them green beans until they were limp. Them things supposed to be what? Crunchy. Cabbage supposed to be what? Steam. Am I talking? But people just want to stuff themselves full of what? Of food that don't have no life. Then when sickness comes, they say, man, I don't understand how I can be sick. I've been doing everything right. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I don't do stuff. I don't chew tobacco. I don't go to the club. I don't run women and catch them. I don't run men and I am right. That's what it all says. All, I am right. Hallelujah. But remember, Daniel had these qualities that made him sensitive, that caused spiritual things to become easier to perceive. And I want to say this, for those of you that struggle with the revelation, now the Bible says that he that readeth the words of this book, there's a great blessing. My life has turned completely around. The fear of God has come on me. My prayer life has gone up 10 notches. And prayer is far from a struggle. And when I come here, I'm ready to sing in the spirit. And I just hold back a lot because people think, Pastor Hill, he just off. And you know, he's old time. We're in a different age now. You know, you don't take all of that no more. So I just kind of restrain myself, but sometimes I just have to let go and let God. All right, my time is about up. But those were some of the qualities. Now, remember the sixth chapter, the Bible says that Daniel was faithful. I'm going to read that. See, all of these, his dedication and commitment, it's going to be difficult to understand spiritual things. And that's the reason why some of y'all don't come on Wednesday night. Because you don't want to make the effort to study this stuff. And you don't want to meditate and you don't want to push the plate back. And it's going to require that God open up the eyes of your understanding. Because you can have a lot of hope and you can motivate yourself and you can get up in a different level. There's no point in staying up in a babyhood, in a nursery. It's no point in having a baby bottle and being back in the nursery. How will a gray-headed person look in a nursery with a baby bottle in their mouth? See, some of y'all, amen, some of us just don't want to make the effort that we need to make when to grow. Amen. Everything about every resurrection, for instance, Christ the first fruit. 1 Corinthians 15:22 talks about that Christ the first fruits. I mean, this is the order that people will arise and meet their judgment. Christ the first fruit. Now this is something that all of us, every Atlantic can understand. That means Christ was the first one that rose out of spiritual death. But he was the first fruits. That meant when he arose, he didn't rise by himself. A handful of people, a handful of saints rose with him because there was a harvest of the first fruits, which states that when a person made the harvest, when the harvest came, the first fruits would represent just a handful of corn, a handful of that grain brought to the priest, and they waved that grain before the priest, and that was a sign that all of the harvest that was to come afterwards would be dedicated to the Lord. And after the main harvest, he was the first fruits that they brought first. And after the first fruits, what came later? The main harvest. And after the main harvest came the gleanings, because the harvest always left behind a whole lot of what? Loose corn. So, if you understood the feast of the harvest, that means the first fruit thing is divided into three parts. So when Christ came and rose from the dead, Christ got up from the dead, and the saints that appeared in Jerusalem